Welcome everybody who's joining us. It's great to see some new faces. And if you've been with us, you know that this is a presentation of the Next Festival of Emerging Artists. I'm Peter Askim. I'm the artistic director of the Next Festival. And we've been doing events since March, and we're in the middle of a four-week festival with workshops and talks and masterclasses and great artists. And it's especially exciting for me today because a dear friend of mine and a longtime participant in the festival, our composition faculty, Aaron Jay Kernis, is here. And he's just a wonderful, wonderful, dedicated teacher. And he and I started talking a few years ago after I had started the festival about what's the best way that we can serve young composers. And he and I came up with the idea for our composer workshop, which is now also has a choreographic counterpart to it. And we're in the middle of that. Two great projects that Aaron and Derek Bermel are heading up with the Next Festival of Emerging Artists. It's great to see everybody here, and so excited to hear from Aaron. He's really interested to talk about the intersection of art and music and politics. So if you're tuning in, you probably know about Aaron. He's an amazing composer, Grammy winner, Pulitzer Prize winner, member of the faculty at Yale, and one of the most personal and moving composers that I know. So thanks for joining us, and I'll turn it over to you, Aaron.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you. That's great. It's great to see you all. And actually, I would like you to turn your cameras on, because I would like to see you, if you don't mind. I don't want to hear you quite yet. That will come later. I'm glad that you have your audio turned off for the moment. And thank you for that lovely introduction, Peter, as well. What I'd like to do, this is really more, I'm going to present some stuff, but after that, I more would like to hear from you. The title of my talk, which I can barely remember, had a question mark in it. And it started with I ask, and then there's a question mark, and it had to do with politics and music. And the reason for this this title and this question mark, let me explain. I live up in Washington Heights in New York City. And I'm here with my wife and two kids. My two kids are teenagers, they're 17. And back in March, middle of March, I had the coronavirus. And I was very lucky to have a rather mild case. It lasted 2 weeks. There were some very, very scary days. There were like seven scary days, but nothing that required me to go to the hospital. And then it kind of gradually, over two more weeks, dissipated. Even though I had it, and I don't know if I have antibodies yet, even though I am still finding myself very uncomfortable doing something which I'd really like to do, which is to join the protests that have been going on, as you know, for weeks all over Manhattan. That in the past would be something I typically would be right there joining in. But between the fact that of the large crowds, even with the attempt, you know, even with the number of masks that are being worn, which I think people are pretty good here in New York City about, even so, I'm still apprehensive to joining the protests. Not so much because of the first bunch of days where there was all the looting and all the violence. Things have very much, if you're not here in New York City, they've calmed down considerably, and things are very peaceful, very, very well organized, and happening all over the city all the time. but during this period is very, very much in my mind the question of, you know, what can I do? What can musicians do? We are limited now in, of course, in our ability to play for people live, to have that, to share that experience where we're learning how to navigate so much technology in so many different ways, as of course I'm seeing you with, to connect to people. That this is a very continuously raised question for me. How can I do more? What can I do? What can we do? So, and over my career, successful or not, or influential or not, mostly not, there I have written a series of pieces that, whether it's directly involved with politics, well, that's not so much necessarily the case, but there's a lot of interaction with the world in my work, a lot of concern from time to time in my work about world events that are very much on the surface of how I talk about them and how I write about them and titles and things like that. So, and I'm going to play one of those pieces for you and explore that a little bit. That's the first part of the presentation. But before I talk about that, just to mention some examples of my work that has had some intersection with world events. The piece I'll be playing for you came about because of a reaction of wanting to have some kind of musical response to the LA riots in 1992. I subsequently wrote a piece very important for me for my development, my Second Symphony, which is a response to the Persian Gulf War and to the loss of life, to the kind of technological warfare that was being used for the first time in that conflict. And even though it's called Second Symphony, the titles of the movements, the first is called Barricade, the first is called Alarm, and the second is called Air/Ground. And that is both an air, a singing air, and a ground, kind of ground-based thing at the same time, that it very much to me brought to mind kind of the new air-to-ground missiles that were being used in that conflict. And the third movement is called Barricade, and it has a certain amount of built-in unmentionable tension and leads to a kind of deafening, absolutely deafening climax that seeks to, in experience, in the concert hall, have some totally visceral experience for the audience, is as if they've been swiped off the earth. Other works of mine, I wrote a whole series of works related to, that started in relationship to the conflict in Bosnia, and that widened its concern as that developed into not just genocide, but the Holocaust and the relationships between the kind of genocide we've seen in the 20th century, in the late 20th century, and a kind of starting place in the Holocaust and earlier conflicts in the century. My most recent piece that I would say in some ways political is a horn concerto that's called Legacy. And it was being premiered at the Grant Park in Chicago. And I wrote it shortly after Barack Obama left the presidency. And so it was a piece that I dedicated to him. It was being performed where he did his inaugural speech and did his farewell. And it uses a lot of the song Amazing Grace, which he sang at the memorial service for the victims of Dylann Roof's massacre. So it's in this way that, you know, there are in these works a lot of subtext, a lot of stuff. You know, if you just heard it without reading the program notes, you probably wouldn't know very much, but it's important to me to add some cues through titles, through a kind of great physicality to the music, to allude to these political and world issues and conflicts. So what I'd like to do is play for you one piece, which at this point is it's from 1992, which is what, 30, wait, how many years old is that? Let's see, 28 years old. It feels still very new to me. It's called New Era Dance. And as I mentioned a minute ago, it came about as a response, kind of response to the LA riots. And the reason I'm playing this piece for you now is because I recommend very highly that you try to watch Anna Deveris Smith's theater piece called Twilight, which has been on PBS Great Performances recently, which is a kind of chronicle by that actress of the LA riots in 1992. So at that time, that was the LA riots after the Rodney King beating. At that time, I've lived in this neighborhood in Washington Heights since then. And there was a sense that the riots were spreading, that they would be in Atlanta and that they would come to New York City. There was some looting in my neighborhood. There was a real sense of the idea that these demonstrations were going to spread around the country. And there's certainly a lot of echoing of this time and the reactions to the police and to the brutality against Black people. And so it very much feels like a parallel time. And one can only hope that through the size and the proliferation of protests going on now, that we can only hope that something actually changes, that this actually affects some change, because even with the vociferousness and the strength and the very difficult time of the LA riots, not very much changed between them. And the issues were the same, and those reactions did not really lead to much change in how people were treated. So, and the funny thing about writing this piece is in some ways it's a lighthearted piece, but in some ways it's very dark indeed. This writing this piece coincided with a couple of things. 1992, November of 92, I believe, was the next election. So it was what was going to be the end of the Bush years and the beginning of the Clinton years. And also that coincided at the New York Philharmonic, who commissioned the piece, with the start of a term of the end of one conductor and the beginning of the term of Kurt Mazur, which this was kind of in celebration of a new time at the New York Philharmonic. But that was a kind of frame to hang it on. That's the first thing I say in the dedication. But what it was really about was hope for a new time, looking toward the millennium in 2000, and hoping that things were going to change. And in fact, my program notes, which is very simple, says, New Era Dance is dedicated and written in celebration of a new era of leadership at the New York Philharmonic, in anticipation of the new millennium to come in the year 2000, and in hope for a time of imperative political and social change in this country. Now this is a, thank you, Peter. This is like a 7-minute piece. It is a curtain raiser piece. It's a high energy piece that I wanted to reflect in some ways the urban life in New York, but also it starts, my planning for the piece, once I'd written the first couple of rhythmic ideas, did something that I really haven't done since, where I looked to sound effects libraries. And I wanted to find some sounds that would reflect the kind of moment that I felt we were at. And they're in three parts. These sounds are in three parts, and they're very related. The first group of sounds are sounds of conflict, are sounds of urban conflict, gunshots, sirens, planes going overhead. And Peter, if you could play the first of these three sound collages, you'll hear what I mean.
Thank you.
Okay, that's the first one. And that starts pretty much right after the piece begins. I worked with a sound engineer who put these together, and you know, it's a combination of quite a lot of sounds from many different sources. Now that happens at the beginning of the piece in the maybe pretty much at the about 3/5 in or so, the second sound collage happens. And as the piece starts with that kind of conflict that you heard, and then there's a lot of dance music that starts in a very upbeat way and gradually becomes more dark and more ominous. And as that ominous music continues, as that's building up, the second sound collage occurs, which is sounds of protest, sounds of bombing, of firebombing. And Peter, if you'd play the second sound collage. And the third sound collage is at the very, very end, when the opening of the piece returns. And it's like the reverse of those opening sounds. It's sounds of celebrations. There's still bombs going off and sirens, but they're fireworks, they're celebratory. So if you play that as well, Peter. Thank you. Okay, so those are three sound collages, and the unfortunate thing here, now you're going to have to kind of use your imagination, because unfortunately when this piece was recorded, and it was recorded in like 1993 with the Baltimore Symphony and David Zinman, the engineer I was working with refused to turn these up. So you can barely hear them in the mix. You can hear the opening one, the ending one a little bit, but in the middle, he just would not crank up the volume. So in performance, these sounds are usually heard over a PA system in front of the orchestra. And part of the effect of this piece, it's an interesting mix of things, because yes, it's very upbeat and very rhythmic and all that. But I did want to make the audience kind of uncomfortable with the volume of these sounds, with the intensity of these sounds, and which unfortunately the recording sounds very nice and cheery and very kind of medium tempo paced. And I tend to like it a little faster. It's a very accurate recording, very good recording, but it lacks that kind of urgency. But it's the only good recording with good sound that I have. This piece was done a great deal. After 5 years of not being done once it was premiered, it started to show up with through a lot of orchestras, and especially whenever new music directors would be entering into a new season, new era dance would often be played. And I think that there was a kind of unfortunate for me and a kind of ironic lack of awareness of what was actually going on in the piece. It just kind of sounds like a concert opener, but there's all this other stuff going on. Okay, I want to play it. And there's the absolute dead center of the piece. The orchestra has to chant, and for me at that time I thought that was like rapping, but for most people it sounds like a march. So I think rap is not quite in my nature, but I gave it a try. And it was another thing to make orchestra members uncomfortable, because I knew if they had to do that, only the youngest people would be really into it, and the older ones would like, what am I doing here? I'm not being paid to chant here. You know, this is not part of my job, my job description. So we'll play that in a minute, but I do want to say, after that section, that dead center of chanting, there's a kind of very bright, very tonal, almost militaristic kind of music before the final big phrase. And I'm very torn. When I wrote that at that time, I thought it was very upbeat and looking to a new, to a new era, to a new time, to change. But the more I heard that section, the more I heard it as a kind of triumph of American militarism, as a kind of having a really, really ironic side to it that made me uncomfortable, actually. So let's play New Air Dance for you. It's in total about 7 minutes, and you'll hear little hints of those sound collages that I played, but not so much, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Okay, so that's New Era Dance. And, you know, at the very, very end, before the brass, you know, do their very slow glissando, that's when all the fireworks occur. And before, if you didn't understand what they were chanting, the orchestra's chanting new era, over and over again. And there's certain orchestras, if I happen to be there in orchestra, there were some that chanted nude Aaron, and others that thought that new era was the detergent, but most understood that it was new era. I want to show you something that one of the nice effects of this piece, other than being done by a number of orchestras, that is a world that is not one that I know very well, is the piece has made it to a number of drum corps tournaments and in arrangements. And I'd like to play you a little excerpt of one of these drum corps presentations. And there are a lot of really cool things about these drum corps situations, where, you know, all the music is memorized, it's completely choreographed, it's completely rearranged. They have very dedicated, very, very smart arrangers. And I'm just gonna play you like a 1.5 minute excerpt of one of these arrangements. And in a way, I feel like that in a way that's like the most thing, in a way I'm almost feel like, you know, if through this happening, I feel like I've really made it. If the music has gone to kids who memorize, who get to know it fully, get to completely physicalize it. And that's very exciting to me. And we recently, a band arrangement of it was made too. And it's just, even though it's only been done a few times, the thought that the music goes out to younger and younger generations of performers is very satisfying to me. So I'd like to show you this little excerpt of a, I think this is I forget which year this is actually, whether it's 2018 or 1999, but it's been done a few times with a drum corps situation. It's really fun to see. The energy is wonderful. So let me say most of all that whenever any of the music that I make has some allusions to world events, political events, whatever, the music comes first, and the whatever influences it creates a subtext, an emotional subtext, that allows me, through the play of emotions, through structuring a series of like gateways and narrative gateways that gives the music its drama, its structure, hopefully its impact, but it's really the emotions that I feel from a reaction to these events in the world that fuel the building of these, you know, of these big structures from 8 minute pieces to 30 whatever minute symphonies. But it's not the other way around. It's not that the political of it is so much on the surface. It's there, it's embedded in the way the work was created. But as I said, the music, the development of the music, the narrative, the work comes first. That's what's crucial to me. But at the same time, I feel like I can put myself and put my feelings, my reactions fully into this work, yet find ways to use it as a kind of bedrock structural thinking to what I'm doing. So that's my presentation about that work. And what I'd like to ask you all people to do is to turn your screens back on so I can see you. And to ask you, in part because I'm asking this question constantly for myself, for my kids, you know, beyond donating money to causes, which I try to do as much as possible, by voting, which is utterly crucial and something I've, you know, my parents instilled in me a great dedication to the sense that we have this absolutely necessary way of responding through our votes. And, you know, through writing letters, I've taken stupidly to writing letters to the White House recently and to a couple of other governors and things like that, but it's pointless, so I kind of stopped. But, and talking about the word pointless is that this funny thing about politics and music, do we have an effect? Is there any accumulation of effect? Can we expect that? And if we don't feel an effect, should that stop us? Should that, you know, stop our energy and our commitment? So I kind of want to open it up to you for your comments. And then maybe in a little while, if you have any questions for me, I'll, you know, there'll be a little time for that as well. So, want to like raise a hand and then I'll call on you. And if there's no one talking, then we've kind of got a problem. Then it's going to be Peter and I. So Michael, I saw Michael's hand first. You have to unmute. Yeah, unmute. Thank you.
Yeah, hi. It's an honor to be a part of this conversation. Sorry, I'm a little starstruck right now. I met you briefly in Bellingham, Washington last year.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm not a composer by vocation, but I do have a bachelor's degree in composition, and it's sort of a personal pursuit of mine. But I did work, what your question makes me think of, I did work in admin at a local opera company here for 5 years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as the audience became sort of started aging out and our donor base started aging out, we had to think about ways of drawing younger audiences. And a lot of the feedback we got was that these mainstays of the operatic canon are inherently problematic on many levels in terms of representations of misogyny and, you know, still practicing blackface and yellowface in some cases. And so we had like a kind of internal cohort of people that we named the Racial Equity, Social Equity Task Force. And it was kind of almost like just a committee for people to vent. But we did have some influence over our marketing department and it changed the way we had more panels, facilitated conversations around, you know, even though we were still staging Madame Butterfly or Così fan tutti, like we were talking about the problematic things that were inherent in those pieces. And I don't work there anymore, but I still feel like even though we were only pushing the envelope and, you know, we were just nudging things, I feel like the classical music world just has a very specific sector of society that it speaks to, and we have a very specific platform to talk about these issues. And I think, yeah, like, without being too much, you know, going on too much longer, there was one incident where we discovered that there was a very prominent white supremacist that was a patron of this opera company. And, you know, like, I think that sort of, that incident sort of colored our self-perception, in the sense, some of our self-perceptions about, you know, is this a space, is this like a safe haven for people to like shut out the outside world and what's going on,
right,
and to just stew in their own ignorance. And so I think it's important not to create those safe havens, you know, and to like just make it uncomfortable, like you said, like put people in enough, you know, create enough discomfort where you're sort of, you know, encouraging people to question their assumptions.
Right.
And yeah,
they may not even know why they're uncomfortable, but
right,
but very little of the music that we that we make and we love was created from a place of comfort and let's give people a, you know, a warm bath to you know, to soak in. That's not, you know, for us what it's about. That's not what opera creation was about too. Of course, some of it's, you know, entertainment and all that, but there are a lot of, you know, of course, thinking back, whether you had the opportunity to see these, I'm sure they're all available somewhere, but Peter Sellers productions of classic, of the Mozart operas and various other things, and many more recent productions in Europe, especially, that have not, you know, there's a kind of what are called Eurotrash directors, actually, of the canon of opera in Europe, play with these deeply uncomfortable of updating opera into the modern world, and often in extremely uncomfortable ways. And here in America, well, also true in Europe, but here in America, there's still this idea that art is, you know, something, it's something to just be enjoyed, to as a kind of relaxation, as something that's not going to be threatening. And a great deal of that work is not that way at all at heart. That was very well put, by the way. Thank you for
I just want to make one short comment, like in response to what you just said. It's kind of like the NFL, and like some people are asking, why is spectator sports, popular sports, an arena where we need to talk about social issues? And I forget who said this, but, you know, they said, well, they own one day of the week. You know, they have so much, they're such a cultural institution that has so much power in the board, their voice, that it's critical that we, you know, think about that question about what spaces are truly, you know, like, are there any really spaces that we could say are cordoned off to, like, you know, not to shut out the outside world.
So that are cordoned off to shut out the outside world.
Yeah.
Because many of them are, I mean, because of commercial spaces. Exactly. Right. There's the idea of these are separate. You can't, you know, take your knee and have a political protest at NFL. That's off limits because it's politicizing something that is a cultural icon. and that is commercially, you know, such a huge commercial force that kind of goes against all the commercial interests. And that's been obviously a very kind of interesting and important development for many, many reasons. But thank you for that. And it's good to hear that the company actually went to that point, and that we're going to be seeing that more and more, where mm-hmm. companies are going to be questioning what have they done, what have they not done, what can they do more of, and how do they change their way of thinking so it speaks to more people in a more fair way. Is that a hand, Valeria?
No, I was covering my yawn.
Well, I hope we're not putting you to sleep too much. Not, at least not yet. I'm joking.
I just wanted to say that I was actually part of a Washington Chamber Orchestra, and we were about to play your Sorbonne in Memoriam right before COVID, just days before, and how much I loved learning that solo cello part. So I really hope we get to do it again.
Was that in Washington, D.C. or Washington Square or where
Heights, Washington Heights.
Oh, Chamber. Right. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry too. Well, you're in my neighborhood then. And that's a big solo cello part, or you're at least the Heights Orchestra is in my neighborhood.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I did have a thought about this. Were we just talking about how to use music to bring about political influence in our community?
Right. Well, that's one issue here. I mean, that's one possible issue here, and whether it's even, you know, there's a lot to talk about with that.
Sure. I'll chime in later.
Okay. Thank you. Let's see, JE, yeah.
Yeah, so I think it's interesting to think about what role we can have as artists. I know that from my particular situation, I had some experiences with immigrant detention and being in a detention center. And having to speak about that through my art, it took me a long time to get to that point. And now that I'm there, where I had a piece premiere last year that was about it, I find that all my work has geared towards that. And it is scary to do that, to say, this is going to be my work right now. I hope I'm not defined by that in a way. But I think to the point of the question that how to be political as composers, as artists, as people, I think it's very important to write from the heart. Because I feel comfortable writing about this only because I know in my heart how I feel about something that occurred, that continues to occur. And all my work towards even commissioning colleagues through nonprofits to write about these things has, it, in a way, we have to carve out those spaces so that art can exist where it would traditionally not be able to. It's so strange. This was the year of Beethoven. I'm in Texas, and that's definitely a big deal here in Houston, where Beethoven is played just about everywhere. So a project I'm working on right now was a way to carve that out. And even though orchestras can't play, I continue to see this work and the work of my colleagues that is politically minded, come out on top and find the interest in the community. I think it's very important for sure to cater to our community, to tell a truth that may otherwise not be part of the conversation. And that's, of course, our truth as artists. I mean, to me, art is a way to relate to the world. So if I want to relate to the world, I have to relate to it through this prism of, okay, this happened, what happened, and what story am I telling?
Right, that's crucial, yes.
Yeah, so I know that, I think, yes, we should be political in our art in that way, in presenting our truth and making it very clear that is our greatest contribution to the conversation, is our work. And our work being honest, truthful, and saying, you know, I'm only really interested in hearing what that particular composer or artist has to say. So with that in mind, I try to operate the same way. And I think that's very important to being a composer, that is thinking politically and thinking as a citizen.
Yes, very, very well said. Very well said. And especially working from the heart, being, I mean, there's no time to be anything but honest, I think, and to be real in ourselves. Yeah, hopefully the last thing we're being is kind of fake and plastic and another character who we aren't. Hopefully we're being as real as possible. Any other hands, any other comments? And certainly if there aren't, I'd like to see if you had any questions for me, because we're going to be shifting to Joshua Roman in about 9 minutes. So, but Valeria, you raised your hand first and then Bob.
Yeah, I just wanted to share my little experience that I had with that during the protests in the last 2 weeks. I've been taking out my cello to play for the 7 p.m. cheer here in New York, and taking it out outside. Like, I have a street cello, like a gig cello that I take outside. And I've gotten to know my neighbors pretty well over the past weeks that I was doing it. And I knew that some of them were feeling very protective, and they were really scared about what would happen to their property. And like, everybody, for whatever reason, was in a lot of pain. Either people were terrified, or people were empathizing with the cause. And, you know, it's a very triggering topic. And it's, whether you're a person of color or not, we all have been treated in a way that wasn't fair to us. And, you know, you can relate to it on a number of levels. But I took out, and like that whole week I played either works by African-American artists or songs by like popular African-American artists, things that people would remember, and realize that no matter how tumultuous this cause is, tumultuous the time is, the cause is very noble. So to bring out, to bring my music out on the street and to keep reminding people that this is going to pass. And I mean, people had different reactions to it. People were, the ones who were terrified did feel soothed by the music. Others that felt like they identified with the cause more on a personal level felt that just that, you know, there was so much negative media, like especially on cable news and the way these protests were portrayed, to keep reminding them that that's not how it actually is, and that much of these protests were very, there was a lot of solidarity, and just people, what I witnessed is people treating each other kinder. And that was really wonderful to just be in that space and try to bring that to people who aren't able to protest, whether they're in a high risk category or whatnot. So I felt, it was a little bit scary because I knew that people, my neighbors all had different takes on the situation. But it felt really good to remind myself and others that this is a very noble cause, no matter how tumultuous it feels in the moment. So, yeah, just, and also I knew that I would be moving in a few weeks from this neighborhood. So I was just like, whatever, I'm going to say what I say and whether they think.
I think bringing music out into the streets now is, if you can find a place where you feel safe enough to do that, and that kind of communication, I think is a wonderful thing and very much needed.
So it
feels so isolated. You know, it's so easy to feel isolated all the time, and you know, unless you're a pianist and you can't get your piano out onto the street. We have other ways.
It felt great on a number of levels. I mean, it was healing to me. It was healing to others. It made people think, perhaps shift their perspective on what's going on in the news and what they're showing in the news anyway. Yeah. So that's just my little, like, 2 cents, my little story.
Thank you. It's wonderful. Yeah. And Bob, I'd like to ask, see what you have to say.
Hi, a couple things. I'm a jazz pianist and composer, very interested in this topic of how to keep channeling these things that are important to me. So I appreciate what you're doing here. You know, one of the things about this time is you know, I stole this idea from someone on Facebook, which is reframing quarantine as artist in residence. And I've had a lot of time to work here. And what I'm working on is a piece that that started from an improvisation based on an experience that my friend was having working as a hospice nurse with a guy who was ready to go. He was ready, and you know his body wasn't cooperating. And I called the piece "Easy Off Ramp," which is what I felt he was looking for. And then I took that piece and took it into the studio, and I've been making some music with the New York jazz guitarist Mike Stern. So we improvise a lot of music that then I'm weaving back in between these improvised jazz sections and this piano stuff. And so there is this subtext, and then I'm working with that about taking something that's very emotionally important and then what happens out of that. So that's interesting to me right now. And then continuing this conversation of how do you make the work that is heartfelt and relevant to more than just, you know, my own little life. So I appreciate that. And I was also struck, Aaron, by two things about your piece that you played. And one is I loved seeing it transform for the marching band. I mean, that was so cool. And to see it live and to see what they did with it and the energy and the dance and everything was really powerful. And the other thing is how you talked about the sense that this section, which you wanted to be sort of joyous, and was a sense you were fearing that it was kind of being co-opted as the idea of the militarization. And what I really liked about that was that you were uncomfortable. And that this sort of the unknown of what happens when we launch a piece into the world, how it's taken by them and how we react to how it's taken, none of which we have any control of. But that sense of, you mentioned a number of times as a composer, you want to have people have an experience of being just a little uncomfortable, which, you know, the saying is comfort the disturbed and disturb the comfortable, right? So we want to have something that makes people think and feel, and then you get this feedback, is that really what I was intending? I'm a little uncomfortable with that, which I think is actually brilliant, and that you can share that given that we never know what's going to happen when we put something out in the world. And, you know, Bruce Springsteen writing his song, which was meant to be ironic, Born in the USA, and then it got taken up as a patriotic thing when it was completely the opposite. And all the pop composers, Eric Clapton singing about cocaine, which was not romanticizing the drug. And so how these things get flipped, and what do I do with that? Because it didn't get it. I think that's important, this as well. What happens once we put it down the world that we can't control?
Yeah, that was a very, I have to say, hearing that arrival in the piece when it first happened was a really interesting moment for me, because as I kind of implied, how I felt about it in the studio when I was writing it was one thing in the dramatic plan, but once I actually heard it live, I thought, what have I done here? What am I saying by this moment? Is this an ironic? Is this the kind of militaristic future that I'm looking for? I don't think so. Or is it joyous? What is it? It's on the edge, you know. It was a fascinating moment for me. And talking about a fascinating moment, I have one moment left before we go to this smiling gentleman who we are not seeing live yet, but who we will see soon. Maybe if there's one more comment, we can take one more, there you are. But I think that's actually great. I think that I really appreciate your very heartfelt and very, very articulate comments. And it's just great to hear about your experiences and also for me to share this experience with you as well. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much, Aaron. It's really great and really important to be thinking about this. You know, I find that a lot of young artists are thinking about politics a lot and kind of leading the way forward. A lot of our artists are very interested in trying to make a difference right now. So this is a great, great topic.
Yeah. Great. Thank you, everyone. So I have to head out here, but hope to see you again soon.